Morning. Subcommittee will now come to order. Welcome to today's subcommittee hearing on collateral consequences of criminal convictions, barriers to reentry for the formerly incarcerated. Now, the Historic Second Chances Act's two-year authorization will expire on September 30th. The law authorizes federal grants to government agencies and nonprofit organizations in order to better address the needs of the growing population of ex-offenders returning to their communities. As Congress continues to evaluate the implementation of the Second Chance Act, today's hearing will examine some of the continuing barriers that former offenders in this country face as they reenter society. This is the second hearing we've had on this issue, the first on voting rights, but it's as a result of, in 2008, more than 735,000 individuals were released from federal and state prisons, in addition to over 9 million were released from local jails. According to the Bureau of Justice Statistics, in that same year, more than 7.3 million people were on probation or parole or in prison, which equals one out of every 31 adults, the highest rate in the world. A recent Pew Center report noted that any benefits from incarceration begin to have diminishing returns after about 300 per 100,000 population, and any rate above 500 per 100,000 are counterproductive. The United States rate is over 700 per 100,000 already. In addition to those serving or those who have served at prison time, even a larger number have been convicted of a criminal offense without going to prison. Now, millions are being released from prisons, jails, probation, and parole supervision every year. They must successfully reintegrate into society or be at risk of reoffending. People who are convicted of a crime are subject to a number of additional civil penalties that remain with them long after they've served their sentence. Often referred to as collateral consequences, these penalties take different forms at the federal and state level. These collateral sanctions create roadblocks for individuals who are trying to rebuild their lives during the critical period following incarceration. For example, many states deny people with certain felonies the right to vote, which in turn discourages that person from participating in the political process. One of the most important aspects of reintegrating in society is the ability to obtain and maintain employment. Limited employment opportunities are perhaps the most serious of the secondary legal consequences of a conviction, since an inability to get or keep a job often leads to recidivism. Federal law requires background checks and mandates disqualification of job applicants based on convictions in a number of occupations, including education, healthcare services, child and elder care, financial institutions, and transportation. Also, unskilled and semi-skilled occupations are regulated by occupational licensing and employment laws. Employers in a growing number of professions are barred from state licensing agencies from hiring people with a wide range of criminal convictions, even convictions that are unrelated to the job or occupational license. In some states, occupations such as cosmetologists or barbers are prohibited from receiving licenses if they have criminal records. These collateral consequences contribute to the historically high rate of recidivism. Nationally, two-thirds of returning prisoners are rearrested for new crimes within 3 years. Moreover, the public availability of criminal records through the Internet has made it more difficult for offenders to return to society. According to the Department of Justice, in 2006, nearly 81 million individuals were in the criminal history files of the state criminal history repositories. When information is inaccurate, as in the case with over 50% of FBI criminal records, according to a DOJ report, it makes it even more difficult to find a job. Now, I've introduced a bill, the Fairness and Accuracy in Employment Background Checks, that will require the FBI to clean up its records and provide employers with accurate criminal histories. Even the Supreme Court, in a recent decision of Padilla versus Kentucky, has recognized the serious implications of collateral consequences. The petitioner, Mr. Padilla, was a lawful permanent resident of the United States for over 40 years. He pleaded guilty to a felony and relied on his defense counsel's advice that his guilty plea would not result in his deportation. But shortly after his conviction, Padilla's guilty plea did in fact lead to the start of deportation proceedings. The court overturned the sentence and held that defense counsel must inform a client whether his plea carries the potential of deportation or risk not providing the client with effective legal assistance. And I look forward to hearing from our witnesses about these barriers and how we can provide ex-offenders an opportunity to rehabilitate themselves, successfully reenter their communities, reduce the future incarceration costs, and reduce the chance that people will be victims of crimes. At this point, I'll yield to the ranking member of the subcommittee, Judge Gohmert.
Thanks, Chairman Scott. Research estimates indicate that over 95% of currently incarcerated individuals will eventually be released back into communities across America. Studies show also that, unfortunately, about two-thirds of them will recidivate within 3 years. High recidivism rates not only decrease the safety of the neighborhoods affected by crime, but also increase government expenditures on prisons and criminal justice systems. As a member of Congress, we have the responsibility to enact robust criminal laws to protect Americans from harm. We have simultaneously the duty to ensure that taxpayer money is wisely and efficiently spent. If high recidivism among former criminals is increasingly a budget strain, Congress should, as we are, seeking out new approaches that facilitate reintegration of criminals into the community rather than continuing to appropriate federal funds to expensive failing programs. Faith-based prisoner rehabilitation and post-release programs have proven successful in reducing the likelihood that a prisoner will reoffend. In 2009, Mr. Lewis testified that the faith-based Interchange Freedom Initiative reduced recidivism among its participants by over 50%. Congress should not discredit religion's role in facilitating reintegration and curbing criminal propensities. Faith-based programs are also frequently less expensive than other reintegration initiatives. When we debated the Second Chance Act of 2007 last Congress, I supported including a provision to fund faith-based initiative because of the proven success and cost efficiency. As federal deficits continue to skyrocket, Congress cannot afford to ignore innovative initiatives while funding traditional programs that have only mediocre results. In fiscal year 2009, $25 million was processed by the federal government and then returned to fund state and local initiatives. This included $15 million for state and local reentry demonstration projects and $10 million for grants to nonprofit organizations for mentoring and other transitional services. In fiscal year 2010, Congress appropriated $100 million for Second Chance Act grants. President Obama has requested yet another $100 million for fiscal year 2011, though the act has not been reauthorized. Currently, 6.7 million people make up the federal and state correctional population, and approximately 800,000 of these men and women return home to their communities each year. These statistics highlight the important responsibility state and local governments have in implementing programs to ease the transition for offenders. But the Second Chance Act shifts the state and local burden to the federal government. It addresses the problem of prisoner reentry through inefficient channeling of federal funds to state and local organizations. I question whether taxing to bring dollars to Washington so we can take a cut for the federal government and then only return the remainder to state and local governments is as efficient, when actually we might be better off having that tax money stay at the state and local level without funneling it through Washington to get our cut. As a former state judge, I strongly support efforts to develop new approaches to reduce recidivism by assisting ex-convicts in their reentry into communities. However, we can no longer afford to spend federal money on inefficient state and or local reintegration programs. Well, I look forward to hearing from our witnesses today and getting their perspectives, and I appreciate you for this opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you. We've been joined by the chairman of the full committee, Mr. Conyers.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This is a very important subject matter, and of course, we wouldn't be talking about this unless Mark Maurer was in the room as a witness. But I wanted to thank Judge Gohmert who was with us yesterday in Los Angeles as we examined the NBC-Comcast merger. And it was a very good hearing, and I don't know what you're going to do with the five-minute rule today, but if you knew how much time Judge Gohmert used up at that hearing, and it was very well spent, too, the time and the questioning. As a matter of fact, after he had asked his questions, you couldn't stop. The witnesses all wanted, they almost demanded an opportunity to respond to these questions. But this committee does so much important work. You and Danny Davis started off with the Second Chance Act, and our staff man on the committee was reminding me that the Second Chance Act, and I always look for a chance to praise a former Republican president, came out of George Bush's State of the Union address. And it was picked up by you and Danny. We ended up with 24 Republican co-sponsors of the bill, including Chris Cannon of Utah, Lamar Smith of Texas, our ranking member, Steve Chabot of Cincinnati, Ohio, Jim Sensenbrenner, the former chairman of the committee, Adam Schiff, Sheila Jackson Lee, and many others. What I'm indicating is the bipartisan nature of this activity and the importance of what we're doing here today. And this is why I count this as exceedingly important hearing. Now, here's the challenge, and I'm looking for some responses. I haven't found it in any of the statements of the six witnesses. How can we look into the second chance consideration and all of these? And we've got a system now that I'll never forget. The former inmate, as he was going out and he was saying goodbye to one of the keepers, and he said, "Don't worry, you'll be back. I'll be waiting for you when you come back." And this is the nature of the atmosphere that we're in. As Judge Gohmert said, most of them recidivate, some much sooner than others. Now, what can somebody do that's been incarcerated for years? He may have a bus ticket. He certainly has no clothing. He has no prospects of a job. He doesn't even know who still lives in the city he came from. Of course he's going to recidivate. But the additional problem we're faced with is that we're in, our administration calls it a heightened recession. We're in some areas, we're in a depression. Now, come on, folks. Who's going to hire a former felon and people who, through no fault of their own, are running out of unemployment benefits? Housing foreclosures are predicted to be higher this year than they were last year. And my city and state was at the top almost all the time in unemployment and foreclosure. So, for us to be talking about how we strengthen this bill, and the fact of the matter is we're in a recession everywhere and a depression in many other places, does not conform with reality. And that's why my remarks are on creating a full employment system, which some of you are already aware of. I don't know what the witnesses, how the witnesses think about what they think of this, but it seems clear to me that we're not going to strengthen it, and even if we do, what are we going to do with all the people that haven't been in the judicial system, the criminal justice system? So we've got to start thinking about, on this committee, the responsibility of the government to create a full employment society when the private sector can't do it. And that's why I've rewritten the Humphrey Hawkins Full Employment and Balanced Growth Act to accommodate that. That goes back to 1978. We had this huge battle. I'll never forget it. Coretta Scott King had to fly up. We passed it in the House with Gus Hawkins, but they were going to scuttle it. And fortunately, she was there and said that she wanted it to stay alive. Unfortunately, it was never enforced. And so I just want to make sure that all of our witnesses and everybody on the committee is thinking about the connection. And I'll put the rest
Mr.
of my
Chairman,
statement. Sure, I'll
give you.
Sure, Judge.
I think we all agree on the end. One of the things that I saw as a judge, statistics, 70% or more were either addicted to drugs or alcohol. And one of the problems that I saw in Texas, while people were incarcerated, we didn't deal with that problem adequately. And something was created called substance abuse felony punishment facilities, where basically you went through AA while you were there. There was high school or college courses. And so just to plant the seed, to get full employment after people are released, it seems like we need to do a better job of helping them deal with their addiction while they're incarcerated and getting them the education that they didn't have when they came there so that they are better prepared. But just from personal experience, that seemed to be a shortcoming in the Texas system, and I was pleased when the SafePe system was developed. But I've heard from colleagues, I hope it isn't true, that that's where major cuts are being made in the very areas that seem to be doing the best job toward preparing people for the future. But I appreciate the chairman's indulgence.
Thank you. We'll ask the other members if they would to place the statements in the record, unless you have a very brief statement.
I'll just wait for the witnesses to start
testifying,
and then I'll ask some questions.
Thank the gentleman from Puerto Rico. We have a distinguished panel of witnesses who will help us consider the important issue today. Our first witness is Mark Maurer, the executive director of the Sentencing Project. He is one of the nation's leading experts on sentencing policy, race, and the criminal justice system, and the author of several books. The second witness will be Maurice Insulam, policy co-director of the National Employment Law Project. He has worked on collaborations with organizers and advocates that have successfully modernized state unemployment insurance programs, created employment protections for workfare workers, and reduced unfair barriers to employment of people with criminal records. Our third witness is Calvin Moore, native of Washington, D.C. He struggled with the criminal justice system as a young adult and was incarcerated over 20 years ago, but has since been trying to rebuild his life. He found several jobs with private companies and the D.C. government as a professional driver until 2007, when he was laid off. Since that time, he's been trying to find work
and has applied for about 42 different positions. He has been turned down by all of them primarily because of his criminal record. Our next witness is Richard Allen Lewis, who is the senior manager of ICF International, a global professional services firm. He manages the National Responsible Fatherhood Clearinghouse and website and provides consulting services to help clients develop and manage effective human services programs. Fifth witness is Pamela K. Lattimore, Ph.D., principal scientist at the RTI International. She's an expert in prisoner reentry and multimodal correctional program evaluation, as well as approaches to improving criminal justice systems operations. Our final witness will be Richard Cassidy, founding member of the law firm of Hoff Curtis, and chaired the Uniform Law Commission's drafting committee on the Uniform Collateral Consequences of Conviction Act, and that law was adopted in July 2009 and endorsed by the American Bar Association in February 2010. Now, each of our witnesses' written statements will be made part of the record in their entirety. I ask each witness to summarize your testimony in 5 minutes or less. To help you stay within that time, there's a lighting device on the table which will start green, go to yellow when you have 1 minute to conclude your testimony, and turn red when your 5 minutes have expired. We'll begin with Mr. Maurer.
Thank you, Chairman Scott. I appreciate the opportunity to be here and the important nature of this issue. The issue of collateral consequences is not a new issue. We have had these policies and practices in many ways since the time of the founding of the nation. In those early days, not only might you lose your job, you could have your marriage dissolved as well and other consequences. But one thing that's been consistent over the last 200 years is that there's rarely been any kind of analysis or assessment about the impact and the effectiveness of collateral consequences. And I think that's what makes this hearing particularly important. The other element that makes this so important today is that we now have an effectiveness of collateral consequences, an impact that is far more broad-ranging than we've ever seen before. And this has come about from two factors. First, the enormous increase in the criminal justice population over the last four decades. We have eight times as many people in prison as we did in 1970. Some 13 million people have had a felony conviction. Millions more have been arrested or had a misdemeanor conviction. So the scope of who is affected is really unprecedented now. Secondly, a series of policy initiatives over the last 20 years or so, many of them coming out of the war on drugs, have further restricted the ability of people with felony convictions, and particularly drug felony conviction, to have access to public benefits and services. And so we have this very broad range. There are a variety of questions that come up in this area. Some of them are philosophical in a sense on, you know, what should be a punishment for a crime and should it involve forfeiture of your rights. There are a number of very practical problems, though, that I just want to dwell on to lay out some of the issues that we need to examine today. The first one, of course, is the impact of collateral consequences on reentry. And it seems to me that many of the policies currently in place are very counterproductive to successful reentry. If we look at restrictions on employment, for example, there are some restrictions that few people would argue with. Most people don't want to have a convicted pedophile working in a daycare center. But that's generally the exception to the rule. The other kinds of restrictions, restrictions on getting a license to be a barber, to work in asbestos removal, to work in physical therapy, are rarely connected at all to a person's past behavior, rarely connected to any kind of public safety objective. So it's hard to see what the rationale is for restricting people from these occupations. Another set of restrictions are the drug felony bans. Some of these coming out of the 1996 federal welfare reform legislation, which prohibit people with a drug felony from receiving welfare benefits or food stamps for life unless the state in which they live happens to opt out of that. This policy applies to drug felonies and only drug felonies. So someone with an armed robbery conviction or a stolen car conviction or anything else is perfectly eligible to qualify, but only people with a drug felony have lost this social safety net, essentially. Another one that's very counterproductive, the elimination of Pell Grants that Congress approved in 1994. At the time, prisoners received less than 1% of all Pell Grant funds, but this permitted them to get a college education in prison. I think it's fair to say the number of college education programs, declined dramatically following the imposition of that policy. All the research we have tells us that more education contributes to reduced recidivism rates. So I think this is very counterproductive. We also have implementation problems. There's no state at the moment that can tell us exactly what all the collateral sanctions are for a given offender in the state. This is not a very helpful way to go about this. We know they're frequently implemented in error. I do a good deal of work on the issue of felon disenfranchisement. One study of 10 states looked at election officials and found that 30% of the local election officials misinterpreted the applicable law in their state, which means we have errors on both sides of the equation, that sometimes people who are eligible to vote are denied the opportunity to do so, but conversely, people who are ineligible to vote in a given state are permitted to vote. And this is no way to run an election system, but I think it's just an indication of how these laws expand over a broad range of areas. There is a momentum for reform. Many states are beginning to address this. I know there's interest in Congress as well, but it seems to me if we care about reentry, we care about doing it productively, we need to reassess whether these policies have a legitimate role or whether it's time to repeal or scale back their impact. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Maurer. Mr. Insulin.
Chairman Scott, Ranking Member Gohmert, members of the committee, thank you for this opportunity to testify in support of federal reform of criminal background checks for employment. Today, nearly one in three adults, almost 70 million workers, have a criminal record that can show up on a routine background check for employment. It's a devastating reality that most of us can choose to ignore, but it's a fact of life for those workers and their families who are living in constant fear of being laid off or missing out on the perfect job because of criminal background checks, especially in today's tight labor market. One of our clients, Mr. William Truxton, a steamship clerk who's worked in the Philadelphia ports for over 10 years, was one of these Americans whose life was turned upside down by the FBI criminal background check, required of all the nation's port workers after September 11th. When the federal deadline hit closing off the Philadelphia port to anyone who didn't yet clear the TSA background check, Mr. Truxton was out of work due to his FBI rap sheet. During the 5 months that it took TSA to process his appeal, where he documented that his FBI rap sheet failed to show that an old arrest never actually led to a disqualifying conviction, Mr. Truxton and his family of four children lost everything. They received an eviction notice, their car was repossessed, and they sold their furniture to help pay their bills. Unfortunately, Mr. Truxton's case was anything but an isolated event. Every year, the FBI conducts 6 million criminal background checks for employment for all sorts of jobs, from cafeteria workers employed by federal contractors, probably in this building, to nursing home workers, to federal civil service employees, to port workers and truck drivers. However, according to the Department of Justice, almost 50% of the criminal records in the FBI systems are not up to date, just like Mr. Truxton's old arrest record. That's because the states are very good at getting the arrest record into the system, but they routinely fail to send along the final disposition of the case to the FBI. That's exactly what happened to nearly 40,000 port workers like our client, Mr. Truxton, who successfully appealed their TSA background check determinations based on the faulty FBI records. Their appeals, which took TSA several months to resolve, resulted in a remarkable 96% success rate, which is proof positive that the FBI's records are in very rough shape. Unfortunately, thousands more workers fell through the cracks of the TSA background check system, unable to get the help they needed to navigate the special appeals process. So to avoid all this needless hardship, the challenge is to get the FBI rap sheet right before it's released to the employer and ends up wasting the valuable resources of government agencies that have to deal with all the fallout from the problem of the FBI records. In fact, that's exactly what's done in the case of the Brady gun checks, where an FBI unit tracks down the missing dispositions before the information is released to the gun dealers. As a result of this follow-up, the FBI locates 65% of the missing records in just 3 days. If it works for FBI gun checks, it can also work for employment background checks. Thanks to your leadership, Chairman Scott, that's the basic premise of H.R. 5300, the Fairness and Accuracy in Employment Background Checks Act, which you introduced last month with strong bipartisan support. H.R. 5300 takes the tested Brady gun check process and applies it to criminal background checks for employment. It's a simple measure, but it's a huge reform of the system, which is paid for with a supplement to the fee that's now charged for each FBI employment background check. In addition, the bill adopts several basic consumer protections that apply to private background check screening firms, including the right to get a copy of the record to challenge its accuracy. Finally, we'd like to highlight a key protection in the port worker screening law, which we urge Congress to extend to all federal statutes requiring criminal background checks for employment. It's a policy that allows most port workers who have a disqualifying felony offense on their record to make the case to TSA that they've been rehabilitated under the law's special waiver provision. The waiver protection has proved its weight in gold. It saved the jobs of 5,000 hardworking workers who TSA has determined do not pose a terrorism security threat based on evidence of rehabilitation. In fact, at least 60% of those who applied for the waiver were approved by TSA. What's more, people of color were significant beneficiaries of the waiver process, given the huge impact of criminal records, especially drug offenses, on low-income communities. Thank you again for your hard work on this critical issue.
Thank you. And Mr. Moore.
Good morning, everyone. I'd like to thank you for this golden opportunity to testify today about the collateral consequences of my criminal convictions. My name is Calvin Moore, and I would like to share my story about how my criminal record has been a barrier to rebuilding my life and finding meaningful employment. I'm 59 years old. I grew up in the District of Columbia in the 1950s and 60s. The district was a very different place than it is today. I lived in a primarily segregated neighborhood near the Navy Yard, where racism and racial profiling were rampant, and there weren't a lot of opportunities for young people. I was part of a tough neighborhood crowd, and unfortunately, I got into some trouble with the law. I had made some bad decisions because of my immaturity, but I paid for them. I was eventually convicted to serve a 10-year sentence, 3.5 years in prison, and the remaining 6.5 years on parole. During my incarceration, I prepared myself for release. I took college courses, I got my high school diploma, I got married, I'm still married. I was released, and when I was, it was still very difficult. I didn't have a strong support system and not a lot of opportunities. Unfortunately, I got into some more trouble trying to medicate the problem with drugs in the 1980s. I also found myself face to face again with the criminal system. So since that time, though, however, I've been working to rebuild my life and start all over. I've been totally clean. I also obtained my commercial driver's license, and I've not had any problems with the law. I found various jobs, some with private companies laying asphalt, and also a position as a professional driver with the D.C. government. These jobs, however, took its toll on my health and didn't pay well and didn't provide any or much benefits. So over the years, I also started developing serious health problems and injuries from my previous two jobs, which prevented me from working full time. I'm currently receiving SSDI, and since October 2007, I've been out of work, diligently looking for jobs, any job, to help me pay my bills and make ends meet. When the recession hit, finding long-term employment became that much harder. I also applied for probably over 42 jobs, but was turned down by all of them. And the reason was that my criminal record prevented me from being hired. In short, the decisions that I made 30-plus years ago and that I've already paid for are still preventing me from moving forward and getting a second chance. However, I went to the D.C. Employment Justice Center last year about the possibility of sealing my criminal record and the district's 2006 expungement and sealing law so that I could have a better chance of finding a job with decent wages. But unfortunately, again, because the law is so narrowly drafted, I was not able to seal any part of my record. So my criminal record will, I would imagine, be a continued impediment for me, even though I'm a different person today than I was back then. I want to be able to help others who are also in similar situations. I recently joined the Workers' Advocacy Group as part of the Employment Justice Center so that I can advocate for changes in the law and help improve the barriers for people with, who have criminal records. There is some good news. I recently was put in contact with Catholic Charities, and I'm in the process of returning to school to become a certified addiction counselor. I'm also hoping that after I become certified, it won't be as difficult to find a job where I can help others with addiction problems. So I'm taking this time again to thank you all for this golden opportunity to share my story about the barriers that many individuals such as myself face with criminal records when they try to rebuild their lives after their convictions. And I'm happy to answer any questions. I'm open for that. And I thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Moore. So, Mr. Lewis.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman.
Judge Gomer and members of the subcommittee, on behalf of ICF International, I thank you for this opportunity to appear before you today to discuss this very important issue of reducing barriers to reentry and to discuss collateral consequences of criminal convictions and how it is that we can overcome those multiple barriers to reintegration. We appreciate your passion and your compassion about this very important issue. I want to speak briefly about the problem of prisoner reentry, how we overcome some of those barriers to successful reintegration, and make some recommendations to reduce some of these collateral consequences that my colleagues have talked about. And thank you, Mr. Moore, for your personal testimony of how this has impacted you in your life and your family. As the millennium advances, American corrections is in crisis. Many of our communities are in crisis, and perhaps one of the most pervasive issues that folks are facing right now and corrections is facing is record numbers of folks returning home without adequate supervision. We're very concerned about that, and that's what's really feeding the cycle of reentry that we see. Currently, there's about 1.6 million folks in prison and about 5.1 million adults that are returning home to communities each year. The real question becomes, how do we overcome some of these barriers? Because we know that the research indicates that increasing numbers of folks are returning home without any supervision whatsoever, and prisoners are returning home having spent longer periods behind bars with inadequate supervision upon returning home and inadequate assistance in their reintegration as a whole. While formidable, the prisoner reentry challenges provide an opportunity to really think about how is it that we balance this need to increase public safety and at the same time reduce barriers to successful reintegration. We know that prisoners returning home have a lot of difficulty reconnecting first and foremost with their families, reconnecting with their housing, and reconnecting with the jobs. And those are the three pillars that we have focused on in our work at ICF and in my prior work with Prison Fellowship. And unfortunately, this problem disproportionately affects African-American males who predominantly live in poor urban environments which are already plagued by profound social and economic consequences. Moreover, as you all know, criminal conviction carries profound social and economic consequences in areas including getting access to housing, and particularly public housing, and getting access to gainful employment, as Ms. Conyers mentioned earlier today, getting access to higher education, as Mr. Maurer mentioned earlier, and getting access to welfare benefits and, of course, voting. Our major concern is that these collateral consequences really are having a profound effect upon folks' ability to reconnect with their children and families. Over the past couple decades, the number of children impacted by incarceration has increased exponentially. Parental incarceration has increased, and there's now some 809,000 prisoners out there of the 1.5 million that we know have children, and about 1.7 million minor children who are impacted by incarceration. And unfortunately, the plight of children affected by parental incarceration, they're viewed as collateral damage. And we need to think very carefully about how it is that we can help fathers in particular who are returning from prison reconnect with their families and overcome some of the multiple barriers so that the children aren't essentially victimized by incarceration. Focusing on housing and homelessness, one of the issues that we've observed in the work that we've done is that we need to think strategically about how to get ex-prisoners access to affordable housing, how it is that we can reduce the problem of homelessness among ex-offenders. And we recommend that policymakers support promising prison reentry programming, some of the faith-based programming that we've seen that can provide access to affordable housing and public housing and reduce the problem of homelessness among ex-offenders and among prisoners' children. In the area of education and employment, we recommend that policymakers think strategically about how to refrain from policies that prevent folks getting access to student loans to pursue higher education and welfare benefits and other income supports that we know that returning prisoners need to support their families. In addition, we recommend that policymakers consider very carefully some of the promising programs we've seen in the area of substance abuse. As mentioned earlier, folks have to have access to substance abuse treatment if they're going to be successful upon reentry, and we believe that that's one of the major issues that is impacting the reentry problem. And finally, there's a real issue of physical health and mental illness. A lot of folks who are returning from prison have a disproportionate number of physical ailments and also mental illness. And we need to think strategically about how to get these folks access to health care and mental health treatment if we're going to have an impact on incarceration. In conclusion, we know that there's a growing body of evidence that confirms that a felony conviction potentially leads to a lifetime of consequences, including barriers to housing, education, and employment, income supports, health care, and even voting. And we recommend that we provide reasonable relief from the collateral consequences of criminal convictions. Thank you for your time. This concludes my formal statement, and I'll be glad to answer any questions you may have.
Thank you. Dr. Lattimore.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member, and members of the subcommittee. I'm pleased to appear before you today to provide information about prisoner reentry. I am Dr. Pamela Lattimore, a principal scientist at RTI International. As you may know, RTI International is an independent nonprofit research organization based in North Carolina that provides evidence-based research and technical expertise to governments and businesses in more than 40 countries. Since Congress addressed the prisoner reentry issue more than 10 years ago, we've made considerable progress in understanding the challenges faced by those reentering the community and the prospects for successful intervention. The Second Chance Act is providing an opportunity to continue to build on this progress. I was asked to talk some about the findings from the evaluation of the Serious and Violent Offender Reentry Initiative, goes by the acronym of SFORI. The SFORI multi-site evaluation was funded by the National Institute of Justice and was completed at the end of last year. The six-year study was conducted by researchers at RTI International and the Urban Institute. As detailed in my written testimony, SFORI, which was a predecessor to the Second Chance Act of 2007, was funded by Congress to provide one-time grants in 2003 69 state agencies across the country to implement prisoner reentry programs. The findings from the SFORI evaluation are summarized in my written testimony and detailed in the evaluation final reports, which are available online. We have an evaluation website, www.sforievaluation.org. What we learned included the following. Individuals returning to their communities from prisons or juvenile detention have problems that span multiple domains and that are interwoven: little education, few job skills, drugs and alcohol abuse, and often mental illness. Things that we take for granted, such as driver's licenses, how to fill out a job application, having a place to live, may be out of reach for these individuals. Licensing requirements, criminal background checks, and restrictions on housing access are among the collateral consequences of a criminal record that provide additional obstacles to success on the outside. We found that SFORI program participants, fortunately, received more services and programs than comparable individuals who did not participate, although at levels far below their reported needs. Additionally, we also found that service received, service provision dropped substantially following release from prison. There were many more services provided during incarceration than after. Our outcome results were mixed. SFORI program participation was associated with improvements across housing, employment, and substance use domains, but recidivism findings were more equivocal. Men participating in SFORI programs had a smaller, somewhat lower arrest rates, but we observed no differences in reincarceration rates after 24 months. In conclusion, although we've made a lot of progress since SFORI was conceived more than a decade ago, it is important that we continue to build on that progress. In particular, identifying and coordinating multiple services and programs delivered in most cases in multiple institutions and multiple communities is a complicated undertaking for departments of correction, departments of juvenile justice. Implementation science suggests that implementing new programs can take 2 or 3 years. Thus, grantees may need more than 3 years to develop and successfully implement reentry programs that address the employment, housing, and treatment needs of serious criminal justice populations. Further, we need to develop a better understanding of the issues that are associated with assuring that programs are implemented and delivered with fidelity. Secondly, although those participating in SFORI programs had better outcomes across employment, housing, and health domains, and were somewhat less likely to be rearrested, these improvements did not translate overall into a reduction in reincarceration. Further study is needed on carefully implemented, evidence-based programs to determine the effects on both intermediate outcomes, such as employment and drug use, and the recidivism outcomes of such concern to the public and policymakers. Finally, I would like to point out that the comprehensive, detailed SFORI multi-site evaluation is highly unusual for justice research. Although government expenditures for law enforcement, courts, and corrections now approach $215 billion a year, research and evaluation funds remain relatively meager. NIJ, the primary funder of criminal justice research, has had a base budget of only about $40 million per year for as long as we can remember. And that has to cover law enforcement, courts, as well as corrections, criminal behaviors, victimization, sentencing, and so forth. Although there are many priorities competing for federal dollars, comprehensive evaluations can lead to policy development, improved program implementation and administration, better use of taxpayer dollars, and improved outcomes, returns on investment that will also make us safer. Thank you for your time, and I'm happy to answer any questions.
Thank you, Dr. Lattimore. Mr. Cassidy.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. The law of collateral consequences in the United States is in a state of shocking disarray. It's not just a federal problem, it's not just a state problem, it's a problem at all levels of government, and it will require government cooperation to improve the situation. You've already heard a great deal this morning about the serious problems to reintegration into the community that collateral consequences causes for people coming out of prison and other incarceration programs. I won't repeat that, but let me say to you that it's important to understand that this problem is not just a problem for people who have served time in prison. As the example of the Vermont National Guard member outlined in my written testimony makes very clear, collateral consequences of convictions can reach out of the distant past and strike down an individual without it, who has a conviction, even one who has never served a single day in prison. Mm-hmm. That story is not unique. It's a story that's played out again and again across this country, and it's a tragedy. Meanwhile, the number and variety of collateral consequences in this country has mushroomed. To date, no comprehensive collection of collateral consequences has ever been completed. But under a grant from pursuant to Section 5 of the Court Security Act of 2007, the National Institute of Justice contracted with the American Bar Association to do the first ever truly comprehensive national study. Preliminary results drawn from 8 states show an average of over 720 statutory and regulatory collateral consequences in each state that was studied. Nearly 80% of those collateral consequences are occupational in nature. Almost every one lasts for life. Once complete, that study will need some support because the information that it provides will have to be continued and has to be updated on a continual basis in order for the public, for policymakers, and participants in the criminal justice system to understand what collateral consequences exist and how they relate to the various crimes that individuals may have been convicted of. There's no obvious source for continuation of that project except the federal government, and I urge you to consider including continuation of that funding in the Second Chance Act. The Uniform Collateral Consequences of Conviction Act, which was promulgated by the Uniform Laws Commission, provides a solid basis from which to organize state law on this subject and is also a very useful potential model for the federal government. It addresses some very significant problems. First, as I mentioned in talking about the study, it ensures that participants in the process understand what the collateral consequences associated with convictions are. The Padilla case suggests to those who read it carefully that, at least with respect to important and relatively certain collateral consequences, understanding the implications of conviction may be required in order for a defendant to make an adequate plea of guilty to a crime. The Uniform Commercial Code, the Uniform Collateral Consequences Act, also creates a system of appropriate relief from collateral consequences. It operates at two levels. First, it creates an order of limited relief to assist prisoners seeking reentry into society by lifting the automatic bar of collateral sanctions as to employment, education, housing, public benefits, and occupational licensing. The effect is to require that government dealing with these subjects treat convicted individuals the same way that they would treat other individuals who admit the same conduct but do not have a conviction. Second, it would establish a certificate of restoration of rights for individuals who have been out of prison for more than 5 years, and would apply, it would in effect lift collateral consequences, accept sex offender registries, driver's licenses, and law enforcement employment limitations. To administer these programs, the states will need to create or revitalize some sort of parole board-like process to receive and act upon relief applications. The federal government can help this by providing some kind of grant program to encourage states to set up and operate those structures, at least initially. You can also help by giving effect to state limits, state acts lifting collateral consequences from the federal level and with respect to federal convictions. And you can also help by incorporating the concepts of the Uniform Collateral Consequences Act, such as its relief mechanisms, into federal law. If I can say one thing and one thing only in closing, it is that providing some method of relief apart from the pardon process, which frankly in most jurisdictions is simply not operative, is essential. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I want to thank all of our witnesses, and now we'll have questions under the 5-minute rule, and I'll defer to the gentleman from Puerto Rico. 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. There's so many things we can cover. You've all done very well testifying today. Let me try to address two subjects. First, listening to you, Mr. Moore, I see you mentioned trying to get your record expunged or sealed. And I raised this issue to the whole panel. Is this working, the expungement and sealing of records? Should we encourage it? Is it consistent throughout America? What are we seeing out there in this area? Would it be helpful for individuals such as Mr. Moore in trying to come back and gain and be employed again? So that's the first area I want to raise, and I welcome any comments from the panelists on this issue, the expungement and sealing of criminal records. The second area is government jobs. You know, I'm one who believes that government should lead by example. And so is it harder to get a job in government as opposed to the private sector? once you have a criminal record, shouldn't be easier getting gainful employment in government, both at the state level, federal level, local level. So I want your testimony in that area too. What have you seen? What we could encourage or not in those two areas, expungement of records and government jobs vis-a-vis private jobs. So Mr. Maurer, if you would like to start and then anybody else.
Well, I think some other members of the panel have more specific information on some of the issues. Just on the expungement ceiling issue, I think there are a variety of mechanisms that we would want to consider, executive actions, legislative actions, licensing boards, and the like. You know, one of the particular ways to frame the issue, I think, emerging research by criminologists, shows us that when a person has been out of prison, completed their sentence, after 6 or 7 years of being out and remaining arrest-free, then his or her chances of being involved in crime is no different than yours or mine at that point. And so that's partly tells us what public policy should look like. You know, if in fact there are restrictions, we should certainly at the very least have a time limit. We also should be doing education with potential employers so that they become more familiar with any risk that they believe that they're taking on. And I think, in general, the expungement process, the pardon process, I think in broad terms what we see today is that it's severely underused, any mechanisms by which we restore rights, starting with the White House and going to governors of all 50 states. We've had periods in our history when it was much more freely used. It was viewed as a much more, as a reasonable, as a charitable, compassionate approach, and I think part of the sort of climate on crime control policy has made these officials very reluctant, unfortunately, to take advantage of this.
I'd like to speak to the issue of public employment. I can say I'm from California. On the subject of expungement, there technically isn't even an expungement policy in California. You can go to the court and have your record dismissed, but it shows up as a dismissal, which in many cases, when you apply for a job, in some cases you can say you don't have a record. For government jobs and other jobs, it still shows up. So there's a lot of variation, suffice it to say, among the states on expungement policies, and they are very important policies, and they can make a really big difference. On the subject of public employment, though, I want to really talk about that a little bit, because that's a big priority for us in our organization. We're trying to really think through how the federal government conducts its background check policies and making sure that the federal government, state, and local governments are complying with some very basic standards that were set up under Title VII by the EEOC, that they're very helpful standards that require that the job that the person's being considered for, if they have a record, that the record is job-related, that it connects to the job, and that has to take into consideration the age and seriousness of the offense. What we have right now throughout the public and private sectors is what Mark was talking about earlier, just this huge proliferation of background checks, huge numbers of workers with records, but the process of hiring any standards whatsoever haven't even close to caught up with the reality of the situation. So it's really time for the federal government, state, local governments, to take some time to evaluate their current standards. Most don't even comply with Title VII, and then work forward from there. In some states, a lot of states recently, New Mexico, Minnesota, Connecticut's just about to sign off on a bill that adopted a policy they call Ban the Box, which removes the question about the criminal record from the job application, and it delays the criminal background check until the end of the hiring process. So the folks have a shot at the job based on their merits, but it doesn't compromise safety in any way because the person is still, they're still conducting that background check at the end of the process. 21 counties and cities also have banned the box, and that's just in the last 4 or 5 years. So there's a lot of good thinking out there. There's a lot of opportunity. It's a good time to take a good look at everybody's policies and kind of move forward from there.
I'd like to address this concern because basically I'm living it. I have a problem with the background check because basically the potential employer gets a chance to not only look at a conviction, but they also get a chance to look at your arrest record. And on most of your applications, They ask if you've been convicted of a felony within the realms of a 5-year to 7-year to 10-year period. And when you put that down there and they have the opportunity to check your background, they decide mainly to not hire you depending on the length of your criminal record if you have arrests, not convictions. So as a combined, overload for most criminal activity that the individual may have done in the past, they may not even have done the charge was. They may have been cleared of it or what have you, but it remains on your criminal record. And as a result, when the potential employer puts this together, in some cases, I wouldn't hire if I was the employer myself, looking at not only the one conviction that you had maybe 20, 30 years ago, but the the combined total amount of charges that you have related to arrests on the record. So that right there within itself is the first obstacle or the blockage toward being respected for who you are today. The changes that you did in your life to make yourself a mature, responsible adult, to try to take care of your family, because that's what, in essence, that's what we all do. We go to work every day so that we can have peace of mind because we have paid our bills and we're ready for the next month when your bill flow come in. But you can't do this if you don't have an income. So in looking at the whole situation, I think that the whole community of each jurisdiction in the United States, really, not just the criminal himself, but I'm talking about every taxpaying citizen, is really basically putting themselves in jeopardy, because now you got these guys that come out that want to do good, but they can't do good because they can't get a job. So now when you're talking about recidivism, that's what's going to happen, because everybody wants to be able to take care of themselves and their family, pretty much. With that said, I'd like to just an idea that I had about constructing maybe a clearinghouse where they, an individual, I'm really basically speaking upon myself, because it's basically a lot of other people that's in worse predicament than I am, but it still all remains to be the same, because it all boils down to employment. If we get a clearinghouse together where each individual can be streamlined or scrutinized in reference to what their record is and what can be hidden from the public and what should be on your record and what shouldn't be. And if we have in each jurisdiction a clearinghouse like that, then that would be over half the battle. Pretty much give an individual that with collateral consequence of being or having a criminal record a chance to take himself and his family. I thank you for giving me the chance.
Will the gentleman yield?
Yes. No. I'm done. I ran out of time.
It's just on the same point.
I'm sorry. Yes, I don't mind yielding.
Ask unanimous consent that the gentleman be given an additional minute without objection.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, sir. My experience in Cook County as it relates to expungements is it's varied even within Cook County, depending on which courthouse you actually have to go back and do your expungement with. So across the state, it's widely varied. And for many people, the expungement process is a daunting task. While there are a few legal clinics that help people, it appears that if we're going to use expungements, it ought to be available for everyone. And unfortunately, right now, the people who are getting expungements are the ones who can afford someone to handle the process for them. I don't know if that's true nationally, but it's certainly true in Cook County. So I appreciate your remarks on that.
Mm-hmm. Gentleman's time has expired. Mr. Goldman.
Great. Thank you. Appreciate everybody's testimony and your perspectives. There was the comment made about, of course, some discussion about government jobs and also about voting. Since we know, from what statistics have been provided to us, 70% or so are going to recommit offenses, then it would seem we shouldn't get the cart before the horse. I mean, government's bad enough. Congress, America looks at Washington and thinks we don't need any more crooks up there than what we've already got. But there was some mention about some time period. It seemed like, you know, it's kind of like with cancer. You know, they got a 5-year window, and you know, if you survive 5 years, odds are very good that you're going to survive as anybody else would. And so it may be that maybe we're looking at potentially a time period where if you don't reoffend in that period, then you are eligible for certain jobs, and you are eligible at a certain point to vote. And it is an interesting point, Mr. Mayor. You know, some where they're prohibited from voting vote, some where they're not prohibited, they're not allowed. And so that is a good point that we need to have better educated folks working to assure that. But Mr. Moore, you mentioned that everyone just wants to take care of their family, but one of the things that disturbed me that when I put people on probation, I made it a matter of incentive, either by maximizing the number of the hours that they had to do of community service, and then crediting those off if they finally got around to, for the first time in their lives, providing some support for their children or families, or even just found out where they were. You know, some of the pre-sentence reports didn't even know where their kids were. So I appreciate someone like yourself that really does want to take care of family, but that wasn't my experience. Everybody didn't want to take care of their family, and it was one of the vast shortcomings in society because it seemed to be a reciprocal thing. And you would think that if somebody went through life without knowing their father at all, without having any relationship, by golly, when they had kids, they would really address that. But it seemed to be more the exception that broke the cycle. Most seemed to fall back into it. So these all seem to be social issues that need addressing. So maybe we can help keep people out of prison in the first place. But the point that was made about everyone wanting to take care of their families, I wish it were so, but it seemed like that would be something that needs to be done to prevent the next generation from following in daddy's footsteps. And I appreciate any comments, insights. All of you in one way or another deal with this issue, but do you have any suggestions from a societal standpoint of what we could be doing to try to break that cycle? Mr. Moore?
Okay. Also, while I was speaking, I mentioned the fact, because I do realize what you just said in reference to everybody is not within the framework of positivism, okay, yeah, in terms of trying to take care of their family. It's a lot to that. During the speech or during my submitting what I have to say in reference to
right,
that, I brought up the point that if we can formulate somewhat of like a clearinghouse where each individual in each jurisdiction of the United States can have a chance to be scrutinized, okay, in reference to what they want to do with the rest of their lives. Because, I mean, I hate to say it, but some people do need to be locked up, you know, and some people are just not prepared. And then when they get an opportunity, they don't take advantage of it, which makes it bad for a person like myself. So, I mean, that was just one of my suggestions in reference to getting an idea to which who or to whom you are really dealing with. I'm not saying that everybody is going to get scrutinized 100%, because you still, even if you do that, you can't understand what's inside an individual's head in reference to what they really want to do with their life. I'm just one of those that I'm to further exacerbate my problem, I'm going through all of the stuff that I'm going through because of individuals like that. So I fully understand what you're saying. You know, I mean, I don't have a problem with the fact that everybody's not trying to take care of their family.
But we do need to get to that point where more people do care.
Yes, sir.
So we break those
absolutely
cycles. But But anyway, you know, time is so short in one of these hearings. You have 5 minutes to make an opening statement, and you submit statements in writing. But really, as you think about these issues, we would welcome your input in writing in the form of letters, suggestions, or something additionally that you want to submit. Everybody up here really, you know, we may disagree about the means, but I think everybody does want to get to an end where we have a lot less crime and we break these cycles of recidivism that we haven't done a good job of breaking. But
Judge Gorman, I'd like to add that a lot of the research that we've done on recidivism does indicate that after about 3 years, the likelihood of you reoffending does drop dramatically. It actually drops significantly after that first year. If you can stay out for a year, and then really tails off after 3 years. There's hardly any data there. So I like the suggestion of considering as a reasonable relief to collateral consequences, considering a three-year time limit. And on the issue of employment.
On that regard, was there any data in what you found that indicated a much higher chance of non-recidivism if there were additional education, mm-hmm. like high school, college course? Was there any of that data in what you
Not specifically on education, but certainly on employment. And employment is mm-hmm. certainly related to education. And what really compounds the issue of employment for ex-offenders is the fact that they do have limited education. They do have limited job skills. Right. There's low levels of viable work experience to go along with that. And in addition, there's oftentimes some substance abuse challenges that we have to deal with. And that's why it's important to make sure that ex-offenders do indeed have access to employment and training opportunities, to income supports, and to even welfare benefits while they're trying to find sustainable employment and improve their job skills.
Thank you.
Thank you. Gentleman from Michigan, Chairman of the full committee.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This is a very important hearing. And I think we can put on the record that that we've been talking with Judge Gohmert and Chairman Scott, and we're planning an extended, we want to continue this subject in Detroit and Michigan. We want to enlarge the panel. We want to bring in some people and hopefully the governor of Michigan, the state of Michigan's correction chief, which is a very effective woman, one of the first female correction chief we've had in the state, who's doing an excellent job. We'd like all of you, Nikichi Taifa with the Criminal Justice Roundtable is here, Charlie Sullivan of CURE, because we've got to go deeper. Judge Gohmert's going to come in with us, and we're going to put this hearing on our website, and then we're going to blog it so that thousands of other people who want to comment will be able to call in and add to it, and we'll be keeping, of course, the conversation so that other people will be able to benefit. This hearing will be a full committee hearing, of course, with the leaders here working with us on it. It's going to be in August during the recess, because we know when we come back in September, all the appropriations matters and Afghanistan and the oil spill and everything else is going to be on it. So we're going to take a full day in Detroit, probably at Cobo Hall, and bring in a number of other people that some of you can can recommend. And we're not just going to, of course, repeat the same thing. We're going to be examining each other's comments and others so that we'll be bringing in even a deeper appreciation of what it is we're up against. Now, Calvin Moore, your idea of a clearinghouse is brilliant. Have you ever thought about a... No, I won't do that. Let me ask you to continue the discussion that our colleague from Puerto Rico began about the expungement and sealing of records and why it is that that getting government employment, especially federal, is tougher because of FBI and other checks that we do that make it even more complicated than getting private sector employment. And there were others that hadn't commented on that part of our hearing, that if any of you wanted to contribute to it, you can now. Yes, Doctor.
Yeah, I'd just like to make a couple points. One is that this notion of automatic restoration of rights is something that is done in other countries, you know, with 5-year, 10-year time frames, depending on the offense, depending on behavior during the offense, depending on the right, and that it might, the committee might be interested in getting some information on that. And I think another important point that was raised is this issue of the accuracy of records. And I think this is another place where the committee might be able to provide some leadership to the various agencies to try to improve the quality of the criminal justice records that are out there and to try to assure that they're accurate, because this is information that's collected at the state level, but it's dispersed primarily through the FBI, as you know, through the NCIC, and assuring the quality of those records, particularly since so many of that information now is available online. So for $19.95, you can get a 1-year membership into these public record searches online and go up and check whatever they've managed to pull together from all these various state agencies, you know, on anybody. And so, you know, the fact that these records are as good as they are, which oftentimes is not very good, you know, you don't have to do a official criminal background check. If you come to me and, you know, looking for a job, I can go up online and pull up whatever people have managed to pull up. So I would point, I think, the committee towards maybe considering that at some time, because it's given that people's lives are affected by that, and it's something I think that crosses state lines, it would certainly be in the jurisdiction of the committee.
Our friend Mr. Mueller at the FBI is going to hear about this if he isn't listening, because I'm being told that the FBI can charge for the cost. It isn't even like they're incurring any debt necessarily. But I would like to extend him a courteous notice of a hearing that we're going to have in August, and I want him to be there, and his person as well. So, you know, we've got to get to the bottom of this.
It really, Frank, if you'll excuse me, it really goes back to state and local governments that have relatively little poor investment in infrastructure. So they're quick to get the first note in, but then after that, there's no system in place to backfill and make sure that things are corrected.
Chairman Conyers, one point that you mentioned about expungement and sealing of records that's critical ties into what Dr. Lattimore just said about public records, and that is expungement and sealing are most effective, quite frankly, for juveniles, because the records with respect to adults are public records, and today, once it's in the record, it's everywhere, and people can't walk away from it. So I don't mean to discourage expungement and sealing. I do think that they.
In other words, expungement is a porous process anyway.
At best.
At best.
And it may put an ex-offender in a very difficult situation where they believe that they're free of their past, and they're asked a direct question, and they don't understand whether they're supposed to lie or tell the truth, and they're on a knife's edge either way they go. So any expungement device that is developed has to address the question of what the offender is allowed to is instructed to say.
Thank you. The gentleman's time has expired, but
could we get
I'll do this in brevity. Basically, this has been my experience when you're applying for employment in either district or federal government. It's usually a process of who you know that's already working within the realms of what you're applying for. And
to help you or harm you?
I'm sorry, sir?
To get help, you've got to know.
No, I'm talking about to gain meaningful employment in the government agencies, federal or district. It's usually my experience that you can easily get in if you have someone that already works within that department and they know you and they vouch for you. Outside of that, it's pretty difficult to obtain a job within either one of those ranks, the federal government or the district government. I just wanted to make that comment. You know, a private sector is totally different, something different. Thank you.
Gentleman's time has expired. Gentleman from Tennessee.
Thank you, Chairman Scott and Chairman Conyers, for your interest and your work on this issue, and Mr. Gohmert for participating in your interest also. And I know you as a criminal court judge have seen people who've been convicted and what can happen. This is a very important issue in my district in Memphis, Tennessee, the 9th District of Tennessee. Hardly a day goes by that I don't have somebody come up to me and say, Congressman, I need a job, but because I've got a previous felony, I can't get one. And they want to take, sometimes they're with their children, and I feel so bad for them that they've got their daughter or son who's maybe 10 or 7 or 8, and that their father has to come up and express to me the situation they're in. And this is because of actions of our government. It's their actions to start with, but nobody should have a scarlet letter for life. And there should be within everyone, whether you're Judeo-Christian, Muslim, agnostic, Christopher Hitchens, or whatever, you should have the idea that people can be forgiven and people can improve, and that's what man is about, is hope and improvement and learning from your experiences. The criminal code doesn't really see that, and they punish these people forever. It hurts our society. It leads them back into crime. So it hurts the whole society, not just that individual and their family, but the entire society. Yep. And it is one of our problems with our criminal justice system. Our criminal justice system has so many holes in it where we refuse to see the truth. One of them is drug laws. And so many people get drug convictions, and the collateral consequences of felony convictions, drug convictions, whether felonies or misdemeanors, are great, and they lead to the lack of opportunities for employment, for housing, for scholarships, for TANF grants, for you name it. It is a scarlet letter that keeps these people in a situation where they're more likely to be recidivists and go back into crime because they can't get into mainstream. So it hurts. It contributes to the drug problem. It contributes to the crime problem. And what we've got to do is get a bill that we can get passed. I've introduced a bill today, or will be introducing a bill today, called the Fresh Start Act. It wouldn't affect everybody, indeed. But it'll say after 7 years, if you have been convicted in a federal court of a nonviolent crime, regardless of anything else, no other conditions, you get your record expunged. You go back to the court that sentenced you. The U.S. attorney can weigh in and make some observations. But for two crimes that we came up with, which would be sex offenders, where we know there's a likelihood of repeat offenses and danger to the public, and financial crimes of over $10,000, where people should know that somebody's committed fraud and defrauded somebody in certain amounts so they can protect their investors or their own business. And with those two exceptions, anybody could go in to the federal court and get their sentence expunged, which would mean they could go back out and say, I've never been convicted before. I've got a clean slate and get a job. And these collateral consequences wouldn't affect them as well. There would be incentive grants to the states to have similar type of laws and pass their own expungement laws. and financial penalties if they don't, incentive grants if they do. This is the type of action we need. Mr. Rangel's got a bill that's similar but not quite as liberal as mine. I think that you need to have, and I pick 7 years simply because the law's got a lot of areas with 7 years and 14 and 21 on statute of limitations and property rights and all that stuff, and it's something that's stuck in my head from law school. Not that much did, but that did. And I think, Mr. Maurer, you mentioned 6 years. Is that the kind of the magic bullet?
Well, 6 to 7 is what the research shows, somewhere in that range.
So we're within the margin of error, yeah, which is better than most laws. So we're introducing that bill today. I would ask everybody to sign on to the Fresh Start Act. And, you know, just some of the things we've done. We did something in our education bill this year on, I think, misdemeanors that says they can get scholarships again if they've committed a misdemeanor drug offense. It used to be you couldn't get a scholarship. It makes no sense whatsoever. The drug war, quote-unquote, has cost us billions of dollars. I presume most of these collateral consequences. And I'm trying to think, Mr. Cassidy, were you the main spokesperson here on collateral consequences?
Well, I wouldn't make that claim, but certainly I did talk about it.
Do you think, are most of these collateral consequences supposed to be deterrents, or are they punishments?
Well, I think that's a very good question. And I think oftentimes what you have is a response to public anger about a particular instance, and the first response is, well, let's go back and close the barn door. I'm not sure they're very well crafted to achieve a purpose.
So you're not saying they're deterrence, you're not saying they're punishment, you're saying they're political Yahoo points.
I think when you have a situation where, for example, in New York State it appears there are more than 1,000 collateral consequences related to conviction, you set up a situation where the net is so fine and the mesh is so clear that it's surprising we don't have a 100% recidivism rate.
Well, they're obviously not deterrents because the crimes that are, crimes that are committed are growing in numbers. And, it's like prohibition. And the American public is saying these are not our values. And yet we're incarcerating people and taking away their rights and spending lots of resources and monies that we should be spending on education and health care and EPA standards and cleaning up the Gulf and all the other problems we've got rather than incarcerating people and putting them to a life of indentured servitude by gift of your United States government. But I thank each of you for your testimony, your works, and I thank Chairman Conyers and hope that we will have a bill on this that we can pass out of this committee and get with Chairman Leahy and get this approved in this Congress. And thank Mr. Gohmert for leading in what I hope will be a bipartisan effort in seeing that we are moving forward with realistic, rational legislation and that we don't have to remove all of our cynicism to get to the right point at the right time. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Gentleman's time has expired. I recognize myself at this point. Mr. Insulum, are arrest records generally available on criminal background checks?
Under federal law, if you're screened for an I think it's wrong. Okay, I'm sorry. Can you hear me? Yeah. Under federal law, under an FBI check, if you're screened for any of the hundreds of occupations that require an FBI check, yes, the arrest is produced. Under state laws, there are many state laws that say you can't provide the arrest record. For private employers who go through the criminal background check private screening firms, federal law says they can't produce an arrest record older than 7 years. So there's this huge variation. To summarize, there's a lot of variation around access to arrest records, depending on state law, depending on whether it's a private employer background check, depending on if it's a federal background check.
Thank you. Dr. Lattimore, you had a excuse me. You evaluated one program where the conclusion was that there was no change in recidivism.
The Serious and Violent Offender Reentry Initiative grant programs that funded 89 reentry programs across the country, prisoner reentry programs across the country, that were basically supposed to do needs and risk assessment, provide education, vocational training, substance abuse treatment, mental health. And what we found was that they started making incremental improvements in the provision of those types of services, but not as much as was needed in most cases. saw modest improvements in employment and housing and drug use outcomes, did not see any differences in reincarceration rates. And part of this may be due to the impact of technical violations, which is another sort of complication when you study recidivism. You've got people that are on parole. Oftentimes you put them in programs where they're actually being watched more closely than the people that aren't in the programs, which leads to an opportunity for them to be caught on, you know, some technical violation of parole. We're still continuing to sort of scrutinize our data with respect to whether and to the extent to which that might have had some influence on the findings. The other issue I think that is important to keep in mind that we have not studied as much as we, well, it's been studied relatively little, is this notion that comes out of the substance abuse treatment area of relapse. And given that so many prisoners come out of prison swearing that they're never going to go back, you know, they're done, and you know, some of them, you know, maybe something happens in that immediate, you know, in that transition period that we really don't fully understand about what all the factors are, the characteristics of the individual, their environment that they're in, the support that they're receiving, or so forth. We really don't understand where this attitude of not coming back is shifting and changing, that leads to something where they get back in trouble again. You know, is it I can't find a job? Is it I got, you know, as soon as I got out, I went back and started hanging out with the guys that got me in trouble with before? So,
well, have you seen some programs that work and some that
There are programs. There's evidence that some, obviously, employment-based programs that work. There's some evidence of positive outcomes with drug courts. Certainly, some substance abuse treatment. Emerging evidence of sort of cognitive behavioral programs that attempt to change criminal thinking.
So some tend to work and some don't.
And it is complicated by the fact that you're talking about, when you talk about criminal justice populations, you're talking about lots of different, judges, you know, lots of different kinds of people, from the first time, you know, marijuana smoker to, you know, people like in our study that had an average of 14 prior arrests when they were incarcerated that time. So you talk about very serious populations or so forth. And so there is evidence that some types of programs work for some populations, but in terms of the full grid, we don't know.
Mr. Lewis, have you seen evidence to show what works and what doesn't work?
We have. In some of our work that we did at Prison Fellowship with the evaluation of the Interchange Freedom Initiative and of the Kairos Horizon Prison Program, we found that there is a growing body of empirical evidence that shows that folks who participate in faith-based programming while in prison and complete those programs do show significant reductions in both recidivism. And one of the studies were more likely to meet their child support obligations upon release. So if I made a recommendation, it would be to certainly continue faith-based programming while in prison along with some of the other programming.
You mentioned health care. Have you reviewed the health care bill that passed to determine what impact that's going to have on recently released prisoners, whether they're going to continue to have problems getting health care?
Just a cursory review of that.
Did you come to any conclusion?
No, I haven't.
Okay. Can you say, you mentioned also children and the effect that the collateral consequence to society, I guess, on the effect of children. What effect, and how can we limit the effects on that involve children?
I'm glad you mentioned that, Mr. Chairman, because that's an area that we are particularly concerned about, is the growing number of children that are impacted by incarceration and therefore impacted by collateral consequences. The research shows that when a parent is incarcerated, the children's lives are disrupted not only by separation from the parents, but also they're more likely to endure poverty, to endure parental substance abuse, poor academic performance. They're more likely to suffer aggression, anxiety, depression. And on top of all of that, they're more likely to experience alcohol and drug abuse themselves. And the lifetime probability of incarceration of those children actually goes up significantly. So the children who are impacted by incarceration are also impacted by these collateral consequences, particularly in the area, I believe, of housing. And as a personal anecdote, when I was with Prison Fellowship, I can't tell you the number of ex-offenders that I ran into and interviewed during our recidivism portion of the studies who, for example, wanted to do the right thing and wanted to connect with their families upon release. In most cases, the children's mother was living perhaps in public housing. And because that offender had a felony drug conviction and or a gun conviction, probably both, was prohibited from reuniting with his family. And those cases, sadly, were few and far between, but we believe that's a good example of how children end up suffering the collateral consequences of incarceration.
And finally, Ms. Insulin, you mentioned the TSA waiver program. How feasible would that be to implement that on a broad basis? Are there logistical complications that would make that difficult to do generally?
Well, I think when it comes to federal background checks, there's really no reason why it couldn't be implemented by the various agencies that are doing the screening anyway. I mean, there are certain resource issues that would be involved, I think, with the port worker background checks. They're charged a fee that goes towards the process. So, but when we're talking about all the state various occupational restrictions or private employer restrictions, I think there are opportunities there, and there are a lot of states that have the equivalents of waivers with different occupations. But I would focus more, especially on private employment, on compliance with the EEOC guidelines, which, like I say, are very straightforward, and they require all the things we've been talking about, that the offense be job-related, that be sensitive to the age of the offense, the nature of the offense, all those basic criteria. They're good standards. The federal government was just sued over the census enumerators, all of them, on the theory of title, on this Title VII theory that the EEOC guidelines, these guidelines have been around for over 20 years. So I think that there's either, you know, you can go at both, and there's a lot of opportunity with waiver with all the federal laws that are implemented.
Thank you. Mr. Goldman, any other questions?
I might just comment, you know, there's discussion about expungement, and there are cases when it would certainly be helpful, but then you guys know as well, there's some cases where you don't want that expunged. For example, all I can do is make it a hypothetical because of the law, but hypothetically, you're a child molester, you're caught, you're brought to court, and because the little children can't remove all reasonable doubt from the jury's mind, you end up being acquitted, the whole record's expunged, so then you go to work for a couple of other entities that, one, a probation office, and then a school, and then you end up destroying lives for which you are convicted. I mean, we know that, like child molesters, the studies I've seen indicate they're going to have a greater risk of reoffending. Some things you don't want that expunged. You want to be able to consider, and some of the EOC criteria are very helpful in that regard. But and then, I mean, I had an appointed case where I had concerns about the defendant's mental state. Well, I brought in a psychiatrist. He was excellent and had been very helpful on another appointed case. But he said he's got a problem, but it's called nowadays under DSM-4 antisocial personality. It used to be a sociopath. He knows right from wrong. He can comport with the requirements of the law. He just enjoys not doing so. And the best place for him, I said, well, maybe you could help us on mitigation and sentencing. And he said, well, yeah, the best place for him, a very, very structured environment for as long as you could possibly keep him, hopefully the rest of his life, because he enjoys hurting people. And I said, that sounds like prison. He said, yeah, he needs to be there the rest of his life. Well, we may not use you on sentencing then, but anyway, there are some people you don't want their records expunged, and I'd hate for a law that just made a blanket across the board. There are others. You want to encourage them to have a fresh start. And ironically, I can help point this out, but under the hate crimes bill we passed, it is a complete defense under the federal hate crimes bill, not most state, but under the federal hate crimes bill, if you raise a reasonable doubt that you selected your victim randomly. I just wanted to shoot somebody. It was a random shooting. I didn't care. That's a complete defense under the federal law, ironically. But these are, but I do appreciate the input. These are troubling issues because we do want to have protection for society. On the other hand, you know, one of the things that made America great is that we are a very forgiving society, which also makes it weird that so many people get in trouble in Washington covering things up, whereas history tells us if you just were open, people are very forgiving. But that's why I'd like for your input to go beyond the hearing today, because you know the reaction of the public. If this body were to come out and say, we're going to let you expunge anybody after a certain period, there's some things that shouldn't be. And that's why we really need to be cautious, or you end up doing more damage than good if you have a law that sets up a system where people are going to get hurt, and then they blame the law, and then it gets even more draconian.
Will the gentleman yield?
Sure.
Is there a difference between expunging arrest records and conviction records? Yeah, I think, ask Mr. Anselm what the civil rights implications may be for discriminating against someone on a job because of an arrest record for which there was no there was no conviction.
The EEOC has two sets of guidelines. One relates to arrest records, one relates to conviction records. There's basically a blanket policy that you can't deny a job blanket policy based on arrest records because of the huge impact on people of color and the absence of any reliable indication that that's a real predictor of future job performance. Convictions is another thing, and that's where you get into these criteria I was talking about before, that the offense is job related, that you're looking at the agent's seriousness of the offense. Not about expunging.
You can't have a blanket policy on arrests. What about a kind of haphazard policy or an individual policy? The fact that someone has been arrested and then ultimately found not guilty, can you discriminate against someone based on that record?
Not unless you can prove that that arrest actually, if we're talking about the EEOC in Title VII, not unless you can prove the underlying activity actually happened. That's basically what the standard is. If you can show, so it's not even the arrest record anymore, you got to go out and do your own determination whether what they were accused of doing actually happened.
Well, I know in Texas, if you're found not guilty at trial, then you can have your records expunged, including the arrest record. So there is no indication that you were ever arrested. But it probably is a factor of cost. As Mr. Cohen mentioned, some are found not guilty and they just don't have the money to pursue expungement.
Right.
But then others, if you're found not guilty and you don't go through the formal expungement, then the arrest record is still out there. If you do, then you can't bring that up at all. It has to be completely eliminated from your record entirely.
Thank you. Gentlelady from Texas.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I think this is always a topic that needs to be periodically reviewed and reintroduced, meaning the topic of reentry. We went through this for a number of years with the Second Chance Act, and I believe that many of those in the criminal justice system, reform system, will say that there are even barriers to implementing the Second Chance Act. There are even, obstacles in its full implementation, not to mention the poor funding that has been allowed for some of the initiatives that have been introduced through that legislation. So I believe this is important. I cite as an example, and I don't know if this young man is aware of it. I would assume he, having a lot of people interested in his future professional football career, might be ready to pounce on this, but who knows? A young man playing at the University of Texas at Austin, our premier football institution as well as academic institution, African-American, was arrested, I guess, along with some others for armed robbery and, of course, presented a story of horrors. How could he do that? Just quietly, a week or so ago, you heard quietly that all charges had been dropped, and he is now quietly dispatched himself off to another university. The question is, will that individual have to forever and ever say that he was arrested? The question is, what does expunging mean in terms of our federal housing requirements? I think someone just evidenced a story about an individual not being able to be reunited with their family. If the record is expunged, does that mean that under our federal housing guidelines, a misguided law, and I understand the purpose of it, would that person still have to indicate that they had been incarcerated and or arrested? So let me just pose this question that I will go. I think I saw something from Mr. Cassidy, and I couldn't determine whether he was for or against the concept or the understanding of how arrest records block the reentry, because it indicated includes some information on the record. I want to go on record by saying that I have an aversion to child predators and individuals that have a propensity of repeating and preying on the innocent. So let me just put that on the table and put that aside. The HUD rules came about because of the attempt by HUD to clean up public housing, where grandmothers either were, I wouldn't say forced, but maybe forced, but in many instances willingly, had youngsters taking care of them, and they were being, in essence, running drug houses because the youngsters were in gangs or whatever they were, and therefore creating an unsafe atmosphere, and you didn't want to throw grandma out, and so it was that you couldn't have these individuals in. That was sort of the underlying premise, and it's expanded so that people coming back, wanting to get a job, wanting to come back to their family, are now blocked. So I would ask each of you to give me your sense of the most horrific aspect of reentry as relates to reentry. And you can cross the gamut. I know there are people here of expertise in work. There's housing. Because I really think the expunging is a very, I think, instructive approach. And as I understand, my colleague has a very limiting approach, which I think this committee should consider. Many of you know that I've been pushing under the federal system good time early release so that at 45 years that you could be released if you're a nonviolent offender. That has caused a fire on the head of many of my colleagues, and I hope that maybe we'll see the light of day of that legislation, because I think that's important, releasing individuals who are nonviolent offenders in the federal system without parole who are just taking up space. But I would like to hear what you believe is the most horrific aspect of blocking a favorable reentry. Mr. Maher, and forgive me if you're repeating yourself, but maybe you'll come up with a new idea that we can have on the record as I ask each of you to answer that question. And thank you, Mr. Chairman, and the ranking member for holding this hearing.
Well, just very briefly, I mean, two actions, you know, that come out of Congress, and I think we have 15 years of experience with them now, are the ban on Pell Grants for education in prison and the TANF food stamp bans, both adopted by Congress in the mid-1990s. I think there's no evidence whatsoever that shows that's had any positive effects. There's a great deal of evidence that shows it's made reentry more difficult. It probably has contributed to higher rates of recidivism rather than lower. So if we really care about evidence-based approaches, I think it's time to revisit both of those policies.
Excellent. Thank you.
I would say the two pieces of criminal background checks for employment. First, get the records right, clean them up so that they're not hurting folks who have clean records and they're still showing up as having a problem, either an arrest or a conviction. And that covers the scope of FBI records to private records all across the board. And then also, you know, adopt standards, and they can be in federal law. They can expand on the EEOC standards that we've been talking about. They can create presumptions based on certain time periods, which is supported by the research. but create standards that everybody that work also across the board, from federal government to state government to private employers, and that everybody becomes really familiar with. That's what we're missing. It's the Wild West out there, basically, and it's time to create standards and adopt and enforce standards.
Thank you.
Good morning.
Mr. Moore.
Yes, ma'am. Excuse me. I myself have a problem with pedophilia, sex crimes, not to mention pretty much all crimes, but those are two major crimes that I really, really have a problem with. How do we address the issue? I keep going back to what I said probably 25 minutes ago about establishing a way that you can scrutinize individuals when they do return in reference to a measure of crime that fall off the charts when we're dealing with pedophilia and stuff, you know, along the lines of sex crimes and crimes that will put people's lives in jeopardy as far as robberies and the like. So in living this experience myself, not that I believe I'm telling you anything, especially Judge Goldman, things that he hadn't witnessed as far as criminals that come before him, and you expunge their record and you really don't know what they're about once they return to society. You really have no idea. But it's been my experience as far as this thing is called life goes. There's always pros and cons and negativism and positivism to each and every given situation. So in order to give the person a chance, you know, like I said, I keep hearing this thing about what I mentioned a little while ago about scrutinizing the individual that you have before you to give them that chance. If it's a clearinghouse or something established where you can get an idea what this individual is all about. Does he have a family? Do he care about himself or the people that taxpaying citizens? And pretty much that's basically what I have to say.
Thank you, sir, very much. Very instructive. Yes. Mr. Lewis, thank you.
I'm concerned primarily about policies that limit participation of ex-offenders in employment and training programs, the receipt of income supports, and including welfare benefits. If we're going to tackle the problem of prison reentry, we have to allow access to those programs.
And would that include housing?
And that would include housing.
And you see the barriers to federally funded housing. Is that an issue that you think is of concern?
Yes, it is.
Okay. Ms. Lattimore?
Yes, thank you. I would agree with Mr. Lewis that job training and educational programming is needed. If people are going to be able to put a decent life together, they're going to have that, as well as treatment services, substance abuse treatment and mental health services are not available anywhere close to the level that are needed given the needs of the population.
So if there are bars, if there are federally a job training program, and Mr. Chairman, I had one of my major infrastructure projects funded by federal dollars. I had the CEO of that project say, well, I think we're not allowed to hire ex-offenders. And I was asking where he got that from. I even asked the President of the United States in a meeting, if federal funds bar someone from getting a job moving trash, frankly. I'm glad that our President said he'd never heard of it, but if I had not challenged, because I was trying to get a job training program, Mr. Chairman Conyers, that would include ex-offenders, that specifically would go and outreach to them, which I'm still pushing for, and that willy-nilly, this well-thinking CEO of the project getting $1 billion-plus from the federal government and saying, oh, we can't hire ex-offenders. So let me...
You should report them to the OFCCP. I mean, that's their job, and I think they're very interested in pursuing that, again, because of the Title VII standards. Blanket policies are illegal under Title VII as applied to federal contractors, state governments, private employers. So that's that. Unless there's some special provision, and no provision that I'm aware of says no one with a record qualifies for a federal contract.
I will dispatch myself to do it because the contractors, as you well know, who are being the major contractors, are saying that, and they also have their own private policies, but they're using federal dollars. So I thank you for that. Can I get Mr. Cassidy?
I'm sorry, I interrupted.
Congresswoman, thank you for that insight.
I think you're hearing the right themes. their housing, education, employment, job training, but all of those issues are limited by the hundreds in some states, perhaps thousands, of laws and regulations that say no to ex-offenders. And there has to be some rational order brought to that system. Without it, people just don't have a chance.
So you're saying that we need to scrape the state laws that block individuals returning to their home states that are just a maze of opposition to them reentering?
It's a state problem, it's a federal problem, it's a local problem. There's got to be cooperation from all three elements of government.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, for yielding to me.
Thank you. I'd like to thank the witnesses for their testimony today. Members may have additional written questions which we'll forward to you and ask that you answer as promptly as possible so that the answers can be made part of the record. Hearing remained open for 7 days for the submission of additional materials. And if there are no further questions, without objection, the subcommittee stands adjourned.